guests. It is my pleasure and privilege to welcome you to the book launch of Lost at 15, Found at 50 by author Ashwini Devare. We will begin this evening by lighting the lamp. May I request our guest of honor, Deputy High Commissioner Mr. Charanjit Singh, Mr. and Mrs. Devare, proud parents of Ashwini Devare, who have flown in from India for the special evening, and author Ashwini Devare, to please come up to light the lamp. Thank you. Many of us in this auditorium today are part of the Indian diaspora, and in this age of globalization, we don't think twice before hopping on a plane, crisscrossing continents, and soaking in new cultures, adding layers to our identity, and being shaped by each new experience. But well before the globalized age began, there was a group of people traveling the world, moving from one new place to another, flying their country's flag wherever they went, the men and women of the diplomatic services. What must it have been like to be a child in a diplomatic household in those days? Being the only foreigner in a strange and sometimes unwelcoming school classroom every couple of years, having to pick up new languages and trying hard to make new friends. What impact a life constantly on the move would have had in shaping the child's identity? We will delve into that and much more in tonight's session with Ashwini. We are privileged to have with us this evening our guest of honor, Mr. Charanjit Singh, Deputy High Commissioner to the UK. A career diplomat, Mr. Singh joined the Indian Foreign Service in 1996. And has carried out a wide range of challenging assignments around the world. Prior to his present assignment, he was the Consul General of India in Italy. May I now invite Mr. Singh to please come up on stage and join Ashwini Devare in officially unveiling the book. Thank you very much. May I now request Mr. Singh to say a few words on this occasion?
Before I say even good evening, I must correct you that in today's function, there is only one guest of honor, that is Ambassador Devare. Deputy High Commissioner cannot be a guest of honor when we have sitting amidst us the great-grandfather of the Indian Diplomatic Service. So, I apologize to you, sir, on our behalf. Good evening, everybody. With your permission, Ambassador Devare, Madam Devare, Ashwini, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. I was trying to find an excuse to wriggle out of this program, and I was thinking that I would make an excuse that I was very busy, this, that, and I thought that Ambassador Devare is here, so he would say that, look, Charanjit, you can't say that you are very busy. So making that excuse was not a possible. Then I thought that what should I do? Because I am not very good at, I am not a well-read man, I am less-read man. So I thought then let me at least have a look at the book which I am going to launch. So during my lunchtime I downloaded a small portion of the book on my Kindle device. And I saw, because today in this world of electronics it's very easy. You can download most of the books on your Kindle, you can read them. It's not like that you have to order the book from some place and it will take months or weeks to come and then you would pick it up and read. Of course, that was a different pleasure. But I read it and then I thought that I can relate something in my life to Ashwini's. Ashwini was born there in Moscow. I was also born there, but as a diplomat. After many, many years, I was born in Moscow as a diplomat, so fondly I always tell my Russian friends that, look, I consider Russia as my second motherland. First is, of course, India, where I was born. Second thing is that I have nothing, the difference is that I have nothing which I can compare with you, Ashwini, the depth and the width of experience which you have. I was born in India, so I stayed in one city, I studied there, because in those days when we went to school or college, there was no internet, so you could not have friends, leave aside across the countries, across the cities even. So that was the time when the letters used to come by post, and as a child I would go out in my veranda and wait for the postman to come, and with the great expectations that maybe some letter would come, I would read it, open it, but as the postman passed by, that expectation died down and we came inside the house. But now the things have changed. The pleasure of getting those letters have also changed. So now we are living in a different world. But we are more connected with each other. So this is the advantage of this world. We used to cherish those letters, we used to keep them in a wire file, if you remember, maybe in old those days. But then I again come back to the similarity which you and I have. You learned to speak Mama or Baba or Papa in Moscow, and I learned to speak the same words in Russian when I was there as a third secretary language training. Then I went on to different postings in the Russian-speaking world. I was sharing with sir that I spent over 9.5 years in Russian-speaking world. So it was very difficult for me to speak English when I came back to India, because everything, every thought was coming to my mind in Russian. So I was doing the reverse process when I was in there. I was translating everything from Russian into English. So that was, because there were very many things whose English word names I had forgotten. Like a simple thing, the device which we use at home, plunger. So I was at loss what to say this. Of course, now I know, but I had to look it up in dictionary and say, ah, okay, this is it. So that happens when you spend too long a time in a particular place and where. And now I found that English is becoming very popular even in Russia. When I went to Vladivostok as Consul General after having left Moscow in 2000, I went to Vladivostok in 2004. And so the things had already changed. People had started speaking in English, but still Russian was the main language. Then another thing which came to my mind, and I can tell the audience here that I read the full first chapter of your book. and whatever she writes there is impeccably true. You were of course born in Soviet Union, which is no more, but Russia is still there, Moscow is still there, those places are still there. So one experience which she writes that is about ma'am, when she was born in the hospital and sir was standing in the cold, just trying to get a glimpse of her newly born daughter and ma'am. So I passed through the same experience, but not in Moscow, but in Bishkek. My son was born in Bishkek. And it was a rule in Bishkek that in maternity homes, husbands were not allowed, or no family members were allowed to go inside. And in Bishkek, I found that all the fathers would gather in the lawns of the maternity home, and on the block, women would have their children showing that the fathers would be looking at the children like this, and fathers would be having vodkas in their hands, and they would be partying in the lawns. But I was a little fortunate, and I did serve a little better diplomacy there. I had bribed the doctors there. So they would happily lend me their white coats, which I would don and sneak into the hospital. So I did a little smartness. I was a bit street smart, so I knew the doctor, so I used a little diplomacy. So doctors would lend me their gown and they would let me in. And sometimes I felt that some of the doctors were there, so they even asked me, do you know this doctor? Where can I find this doctor? I said, you are not even recognizing that I am a foreigner here. But I could respond to them in very polished Russian, so they must be thinking that he is a new doctor. Of course, I was a brown man, but they must have thought that he must have studied in Bishkek and then became a doctor. But that the description which you wrote is absolutely correct. And it took me back, while I read that, into old days where my son was born in 2001 in Bishkek. And I still consider that, I can never forget that, those memories, that this is the other part of the story which you would not feel, Ashwini, but your dad would have felt that. So I can, now I am relating narrating the other part of the story which your dad would have felt, and I felt there. So you have written a wonderful book, and it is a really interesting read, and I'm sure I will go through the rest of, because I have not touched wherever you have been, but I have not touched those parts of the world. And I spent a long 8 years in Delhi, but I enjoyed that also. So that part is still common in our lives, which you, when you were in India. And I'm also happy for you that whatever you lost, you found at 50. And this is so bold of you also to disclose your age. Because people waste away their lives without finding anything. So I'm happy you found something, and I wish you all the very best. And we will certainly have this book in our library. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Singh. These anecdotes that you shared were truly interesting. Ashwini Devare is the author of two books. The first was a collection of short stories titled Batik Rain, which was published in 2014. Ashwini's latest book, Lost at 50, Found at 50, has received a very positive response in the Indian media, including The Hindu, The Times of India, The Pioneer, The Week magazine, Asian Age, and many more. Ashwini is the daughter of an Indian Foreign Service officer, and is the first IFS child to have penned a memoir about her life growing up in the Foreign Service. Before embarking on a career as an author, Ashwini has worked as a journalist and was a former correspondent for BBC in Singapore and CNBC in India. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my honor and privilege to invite Ashwini Devare to introduce her latest book. home to Singapore, set against the backdrop of historic world events. The book took nearly 3 years to write. My habit of being a hoarder, of storing things, came in handy while writing this memoir. Like pictures in a black and white album, the memories were frayed at the edges, but some of them were remarkably well preserved. Running up a Himalayan hillside pulling leeches off my legs, attending college in a military base with American soldiers, covering drug busts in a gritty US suburb, watching thousands of students demonstrate in the streets of Seoul, these are some of the images that scrolled through my life, and I wanted to capture them. What's next? Where next? These two words held great significance in my life growing up as a child in the Foreign Service, in the Indian Foreign Service. Because every 3 years, we have that dreadful feeling of being uprooted and flung to a new continent. We couldn't choose which country to go to, of course, because that was decided by the higher-ups, the headquarters in Delhi. The first three letters of the alphabet, A, B, and C, also determined which country we were headed to. Whenever we got too cushy in an A posting, we knew that for our next one, we were going to be banished into the back of beyond. One of the reasons I wrote this memoir was to explore the fascinating historical landscape, which played out like a background slide to my life. Because it seemed that every country we were posted in was at the throes of extraordinary change. And I felt like I was hand in hand with history, not very different from what Mr. Singh told us earlier about how much upheaval there was in these countries that we were in. And you described a Moscow that was very different from the Moscow that I was born in, I'm sure. But, you know, Moscow, it's the one word next to place of birth in my passport, which almost always provokes a raised eyebrow from an immigration officer or curiosity from a friend. Because I was born in Moscow at the height of the Cold War, and the Russian imprint, of course, was bequeathed to me by my father, who was a probationer, a junior IFS officer at the time in Moscow back in 1966. At the time, it was a very exciting time to be in the Soviet Union. A new dawn was rising over the Soviet Union, which sat firmly behind the Iron Curtain. Every day was a reminder that this was deep communist territory. The hospital that I was born in was for foreigners. It was near the Grand Kropotkinskaya Station. But of course, there was nothing grand about the hospital. It was stark and Spartan, as were most communist institutions in Russia in those days. My mother tells me that my birth created quite a stir because it was the first time Russian nurses had seen a brown-skinned baby, and that too with a head full of hair. So in fact, the girl with thick black hair became a talking point in our ward, and nurses from different departments would come and peer at me in wonderment. From Russia, we went to the other side of the Cold War, to America, which was mired in the Vietnam War, where once again history was swirling outside our windows. From a very modern America, we went next to this forgotten mountain kingdom tucked in the Himalayas called Sikkim, which was a monarchy back in the 1970s. It was a country so remote that even the best shock absorbers could not have protected us from the jarring contrast to our earlier life in Washington. When we got to Sikkim, the pro-democracy movement was unfolding at breakneck speed. As a child, I didn't understand that we were sitting on the cusp of history that would forever alter the destiny of both this Himalayan kingdom as well as ours. So while these countries were in turmoil, my life too was marked by changes. I felt like I was on board this foreign express, and at every station, the scenery changed. A new set of people, languages, and cultures emerged every 2 to 3 years. Going from country to country, school to school, I quickly learned that either you adjust or you perish. That was the mantra for survival. Fitting in acquired an urgency throughout my childhood and adolescence. At the age of 10, I crash landed straight from Delhi into a Swiss school where no one spoke a word of English. And suddenly I was forced to study math and history and science in French. Switzerland was magnificently beautiful, but in the 70s, far-right groups controlled immigration policy, and the country was unwelcoming to foreigners, especially from poor Asian countries. I became intensely aware of my identity and the color. acquired the title as America's murder capital. So just to give you an idea, in 1991, the year I joined as a reporter, the county had 150 murders, higher than the national average. And at one point, I was a rookie reporter who had just joined the station. I was covering a homicide a week. So for 5 years, drugs and guns became part of my new geography. And here I learned to hide my international background because local mattered. And once again, I felt I was tampering with my identity, and family felt very far away. So there are many situations, circumstances, and people who have inspired my journey, just as I'm sure that they have for all of you sitting here tonight. Because after all, we are who we are, shaped by the varied influences we encounter through our lives, the story our grandmother told us, the whiff of our mother's sari, a quiet moment shared with a teacher, a friend, a brother, a sister. They have played a part in making us whole, and these influences are intrinsic to all of us as they hover and seep into our consciousness. Growing up, though, I did not have the constancy of geography, but there was one constant always. The Indian flag, fluttering in our consciousness, reassuring, parental almost, as I floundered, stumbled, and tripped in my search for identity and belonging in foreign lands. Thank you.
Thank you, Ashwini. We can't wait to read this book of yours. We will now begin the main segment of this evening, which includes book reading and discussion. Our moderator tonight is Ms. Penny Richards. Ms. Richards has just joined the Aspen Institute as the Managing Director of the Aspen Initiative in the UK. She has previously worked in senior positions with international organizations such as the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation and the BBC, where she spent many years working in foreign news. Finally, as the BBC's Asia-Pacific Bureau Editor, where she met Ashwini, who was working as a producer reporter at the time. Most recently, she was the Executive Director of the Institute of Masters of Wine, the wine industry's only prestigious international global education and membership organization. May I now invite Ms. Penny Richards to join Ashwini.
Congratulations, it was very special. But it surprised me because I read somewhere that you were very ambivalent about writing this book because you felt you weren't a celebrity and therefore perhaps not worthy of writing a book like this. That really surprised me.
You know, when I embarked upon this book, I was mulling over it for a long time, but it was at the back of my mind. I started writing other bits of writing. Bhatti Kareem, my short stories came along. But I felt like I was not ready to embark on that memoir. As you mentioned, I was plagued with doubt because, I'm not a celebrity about to do a tell-all memoir. But as I started writing it, it sort of led me. I felt drawn towards this tableau that I had. I knew I had the content and the material, but I didn't quite know how to weave it together. And I was also daunted about writing about something so personal. And I think I needed the distance. It was only about 3 years ago that I felt ready to write it, and it acquired an immediacy, which I hadn't felt earlier. So I think it was the timing was right, and also I had the distance and the luxury of reflection, which also made me more responsible towards what I was about to embark on. So there were a multitude of reasons. I think people write memoirs for so many different reasons. For some, it's a form of healing, when you
woven nature of it. It's amazing, by the way, because it's geopolitical and it's personal. It's been quite intriguing. Why the need to knit the two together?
So it happened in an organic way. I don't think I sat down and thought, okay, I'm going to write geopolitics and I'm going to write personal. I think growing up, geopolitics was so much part of our ecosystem. It was something happening outside our windows. Every evening, our father would come home, and the dining table would become this edifice for discussions and lively animated conversations about the host country. We could see history outside our window, whether the students in Seoul were protesting in the streets, you know, going from dictatorship to democracy, or whether it was a tear gas that we could feel. So geopolitics was so intrinsic to our lives. It was something that just, you know, I didn't really have to think too much about it. It just flowed on its own. There was geopolitics and there was me, and it was enmeshed. It was interwoven together. I didn't have to try very hard.
And still is, I think. I'm going to read you two or three sentences. I know you wrote it, you've heard it before, but I want to read it to you because I was really curious by this. And this is when you're based in Switzerland, by the way. You know that. You don't know that. I lived in two worlds, the world of Indians and the one populated by the Swiss. The minute I walked out of the door, I threw off my Indian culture as fast as I could, like extra clothing, along with its smells, language, food, and music. I loved them equally, but I kept them separate, like salt and pepper. Do you do the same now? Do you throw off your Indianness to leave your flat in Singapore? How does it?
I think I've come a full circle and you've got me off guard on this question. So growing up, of course, it was a very different world out there. Preserving your identity was not as do or die as it is today. It was a very different world. The environments that we were thrown in
when you were, your family was embraced really heartily by so many people there. I wonder, there's just one fantastic section I think we discussed this before, so Ashwini knows I'm going to ask her. Please read a section about the time you had a late night visitor. It's most intriguing.
Was a monarchy ruled by a Tibetan king and his American wife. And this was in the midst of this pro-democracy movement, which was just about to begin. And this is a scene that happened, which I heard about through my parents when they would narrate it to me, and I found this is very interesting. Something had disturbed her sleep. My mother looked at her watch and noted it was close to midnight. Then she heard the noise growing louder, a strange, ghoulish fusion of drums and shouts. It seemed to be coming from the garden outside the house. She wondered if it were the lamas, the Buddhist priests, but they rarely came out at night. Besides, the noise sounded very different from the soothing chants of the lamas. There was a knock on the bedroom door. It was Tulsi, our caretaker. He was shouting, "Sab, sab, sir, sir." My mother heard it as "Sab, snake," and shook her husband away. "Snake, snake." Father jumped out of bed, hurriedly wore his nightrobe and said to my mother, "I'll go see what's happening." He opened the door. Tulsi stood outside, holding a candle in his hand. "Sab, sab." Tulsi appeared breathless, unable to utter anything apart from "sir." "What's the matter?" Tulsi asked my father, realizing it was not a snake that had distressed his household health. "Sab, the queen," said Tulsi finally. "What about the queen?" asked my father, looking irritated. Tulsi must have had a bad dream. These locals were obsessed with the king and queen. "Sab, she's standing at the door." "What nonsense," Tulsi scolded my father. "Really, Sab?" My father strode past Tulsi into the living room. To his complete horror, the Gyalmo, the queen of Sikkim, stood in front of him with a group of Sikkimese men and women behind her, all dressed in strange ghostly costumes. She was wearing a black cape and a pointy witch hat with black gloves and boots, and she held a drum in her hand. Nothing at all like the golden silk bakus and pearls she usually wore. The American wife of the king of Sikkim, Hope Cook, in his living room? My father rubbed his eyes, wondering if it all was a dream. "Your Highness, what brings you here at this time?" Before my father could finish his sentence, the Gyalmo had grabbed him by the shoulder. "Let's have some fun," she said, twirling my bewildered father around the living room as the beat of the drums drowned out any further conversation. My mother, who had just walked into the living room, was horrified to see the Gyalmo and her husband circling around the room. Tulsi hovered by the fireplace, looking dumbstruck. The drums continued to roar, and suddenly, Gyalmo thrust my father's hand into my mother's, asking them to continue dancing. As quickly as she had appeared in the living room, Gyalmo and her troop vanished into the blackness of the night. Later it came to light that it was Halloween night in her home country, which had got the American queen into a mood to celebrate her native festival. It was also the last time my parents could see the queen laughing and enjoying herself as freely as she did in our living room. The tumultuous political events that were to follow would transform her life dramatically. The first secretary of the political office, dancing to the tune of the queen of Sikkim, became a royal piece of gossip about my father in Gangtok.
So much of this book is recollections, obviously, of your time, because it's a memoir, but I also think it's a love story to your parents. I don't know whether you were aware of that when you were writing it. There was, you know, clearly when you were a teenager in Switzerland, you didn't love them as much as you do, but it was, I felt it was a real on to family and commitment and good parenting.
Well, the first few chapters in this book are based on those early eras of the 60s and the 70s where my parents were embarking on this journey. And to tell you the truth, Penny, when I decided to write this memoir, I did a lot of work Russia. So they were wide-eyed, you know, very adventurous. They were free-spirited and curious about these new environments that they were trusted. So I decided to write about them, looking at it through a writer's lens, and sort of make them more multi-layered or complex as characters, as opposed to mom and dad. So, but yes, I was deeply inspired by their journey and their resilience in overcoming the odds that came their way in those first 10, 20 years.
I understand.
They don't like me talking about
these characters, but they also were your parents, and you know, reading it, I was very moved by the deep roots of your family, of the four of you moving from country to country, being this incredibly self-sufficient, supportive network. Were you aware of that when you were writing this?
In some ways I was. I think because we were thrown in foreign environments every 2 to 3 years, we became a close unit. Because it was so disruptive, and we didn't, in some places we had no other community to turn to, it made us, in some ways, it forced us to be together. And I think it was also because, you know, the four of us would discuss situations, the host countries. It was a very educative experience as well. The world was our classroom, and I think just being in these alien lands brought us together.
I'm going to read you something else that you wrote, so it won't come as a surprise to you. You're talking about your father, and you said, "My father's patriotism towards his country wrapped him tightly from head to toe. He was unflinchingly loyal to his country." I love that. I think it's a really moving way to describe patriotism. Did your parents raise an Indian?
That's Penny Richards, former editor of BBC, and she's got me now. Yes and no. So that ambivalence is still very much part of my identity. So in some ways, growing up for years, Indian side of me was in the background because, you know, it was about coping, it was about assimilating, it was about the last thing I wanted to do was, you know, focus on my Indian identity. But growing up and over the years, age and turning 50 and all these wonderful things, I think you start to embrace your identity, and the world has changed along with me, making it easier for me today to be proud of who I am. So yes, I think I've become an Indian now after all these years. But I just wanted to add to that point about patriotism that you mentioned. As children, it would drive us crazy because, you know, he would accept to go to places that we didn't want to go to. So we would say things, we would feel that we didn't sign up for this. You know, why do we have to go to all these places? And a lot of children in the foreign service went to boarding schools. But, you know, my mom said, nothing doing, you're going to go with us. So we tagged along with them from country to country. And at the time, of course, we were very unhappy and it was very, very difficult. But now, in hindsight, I think it was an incredible and enriching experience.
You moved to Singapore in your book and in real life, and you said, along with many others, we had come to Singapore in search of a place called home. Did you recognize you were searching for a home, for stability?
I don't think I recognized that for a long time. But today I feel home is an abstract montage of images. Home is Singapore because I live in Singapore. Home is Delhi, where my parents live. Home is America, where my sister lives. And home is Bangalore, where my cousins and uncles and aunts live. So I'm fortunate to have so many places I can call home. And I think it's a good place to be today because it's been the journey of searching, of this restless search for home, looking for your roots. And maybe home isn't just one permanent thing. Home is just an abstract imagery, really. Many people, especially in this globalized world today that we live in, the more homes we have, I think maybe the happier we will be.
I think I agree with that. So brings me to the question, and I think we might have gleaned the answer, but I haven't actually asked you this. Tell me about the title, Lost at 1500.
so many other places you talk about. It was difficult being a teenager in Delhi. If anyone has grown up in Delhi, any women who have grown up here in Delhi will tell you that it was not an easy thing to navigate the streets of Delhi. They were mean, they were merciless, and you had to be on your feet. I mean, a lot of Delhi people here, you were always looking over your shoulder. And unfortunately or fortunately, I don't know if things have really changed for the better. Even today, you know, young women are always looking over their shoulder in Delhi. And yes, Delhi was a difficult place for a woman. It was when I was 15, and it probably is when I'm 50 as well.
I just wanted to refer to a phrase that your sister conjured up, which made me laugh so much. And you mentioned quite a few times in the book, PTDP, postings, transfers, demotions, promotions. The obsession that inevitably, I think, as an international person, you have with what's next, where next, who's next. Is that again why you've chosen such stability, do you think, to avoid